All right, good evening, everyone. I call the January 6, 2022 Keystone Central School District Board of Directors meeting to order at 6:37. We will start with the salute to the flag and a moment of silence.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, and liberty.
Roll call, please.
Mrs. Donahue.
Here.
Mr. Alling.
He said he might not. He's not here.
Mr. Johnston.
Here.
Mr. Koch. Ms. Lynch.
She's there, but she's muted.
Ms. Lynch?
She may not be able to. Hold on.
Mr. Miller?
Here.
Mr. Knopf?
Here.
Mrs. Smith?
Here.
And Mr. Strauss?
Here.
Roger, I see you're unmuted now. Are you here now?
Yes. Oh, you didn't hear me before. I hit the space bar to temporarily unmute.
Nope, didn't work. Elizabeth?
Yes, I'm sorry. Yes, I'm here. Thank you so much for notice. Thank you.
Thank you.
So, 8 members present.
All right. Thanks, everyone. So we're going to start out with a few presentations. Our first one is the FMB Wealth Management Program with Sam and Shane.
Good afternoon, everyone. On behalf of FMB Wealth Management, thank you for the invitation to present this evening at the board meeting. For any of the new board members, my name is Sam Piccioni. I'm the relationship advisor. Since the account was actually opened back in March of 2014, Shane Crawford is our portfolio manager. Mike Shuey has also joined us from our treasury management group. The three of us work closely with Susan's team in the management of the school's cash needs and oversight management. Historical low interest rates have continued to be a challenge for fixed income portfolios that we manage, while having limitations on the securities we purchase at the same time. Although you'll see the long-term performance is exactly what the board had anticipated when we entered in going back from a CD environment and in a low interest environment. So I'm gonna turn it over to Shane to touch on some highlights of the actual account.
Okay, yeah, thanks Sam, and thanks everyone for the opportunity to go over the account this evening. And I just wanted to see if, does everyone have a copy of the investment materials that we sent over?
The board does. Is there any way we can share that for the, thanks, Jack.
Okay. Would you like me to?
Yeah, go ahead
that.
And continue. It might just take a second. That's fine.
Okay, sounds good. Yeah, we put together a an investment summary here for everyone, just to give you a sense of how this account is invested with us. And over on the right hand side here, you'll see the asset allocation is primarily all fixed income securities. We are limited or restricted based on guidelines to investments into things like money markets, certificates of deposit, certain general obligation municipal bonds and government securities are eligible investments for this account. So right here at the end of the year, we're around 98% invested into fixed income, and around 2% is held in a interest-bearing money market fund. the cash flow summary here on the left, where it says investment summary, gives you a sense of what's happened in the account over the course of the last year. So we started with just over, $7,034,000 at the beginning of the year. And with some accrued income, that brought us to just over $7,068,000. And we have income earned. So that's interest on the investments that we've earned, around $147,500. We have our management fee at FNB for just over $35,000. And then there was market fluctuation of $147,800 to the downside, which is reflective of the fact that interest rates moved higher throughout 2021. And the market value of bonds change when interest rates change. So that's just simply market fluctuation. And that brought us to just over $7,032,000 at the end of the year. So when we compute the rates of return, we were pretty much flat on the year with the change in market value. The historic returns are listed here below. You'll see that the 3-year, 5-year, and since inception numbers, those should read in percentage terms, and those are annualized figures. Give you a sense that this account has averaged around 3% annually the last 3 years, and just over 5.34% annually the last 5 years. So we have had positive returns on our investments over that time period, and the numbers below that are not in bold, those are returns for market indexes. So you can get a sense of what the 3-month treasury bill index returned. The 1-to-5-year treasury index, you'll see, had a negative return in 2020, down 1%. And the municipal bond index was positive, up around 0.48%. So these are just general references, for you to see what the various aspects of the bond market returned over those time periods. And I'll switch to the next page, please, and we'll review this. This is just some statistics on the bond portfolio that we have. Duration is simply a matter of a measurement of interest rate risk. So right around 2.5 years, it's relatively a short-term portfolio. So we're not investing real long-term at the present time. And our coupon, that's the amount that we get in income, right around 2.16% annually in coupon payments. Yield to maturity right now is right at 0.99%. So this is a good measure to look at. Essentially, it's like an internal rate of return on the bond portfolio. So when we look at things right now, assuming all the bonds are held to maturity and all payments are made, we'll be right around 1% at the present time. And the other statistics on here gives you a sense of the face amount of the bonds, right around 6.73 million here at year end. And the market value of the bonds themselves without the money market, right around 6.85 million. So that's some of the statistics below here. Credit quality essentially is a mix of CDs. So right here, around 62.5% of the account is invested into FDIC-backed certificates of deposit that are issued by various financial institutions, and we have around 30% is invested into Pennsylvania general obligation municipal bonds, and then around the 7.4% is invested into U.S. Treasury securities, U.S. Treasury notes in particular. So again, that's what makes up this this portfolio. And the chart on the right here gives us a sense of the where the maturities lie, and a vast majority, around 82%. Are in the short-term time period, right around 1 to 5 years in maturity. And we have about 14% mature within the year. So within the next year, we'll have about 14% that comes due that we'll be reinvesting or the school district could withdraw that money and use it if they needed to. And then just a small amount, around 3.8%, is invested into intermediate maturities, maybe 5 years or longer. So, you know, even though rates are low, we expect that the Federal Reserve will be, you know, increasing interest rates, at several points throughout 2022. And if we turn to the next chart, this just gives a graphical representation of the U.S. Treasury bond rates from very short term on the left hand side of around 1 month, all the way over to the right hand side, which is the 30-year rates. And the top line on here, this is where interest rates were at the end of 2019. We had much higher short-term rates than we do today. So that's that brown line at the top there, is where we were a few years ago. And then with the pandemic, interest rates, moved much lower. So the red line is where rates were at the end of 2020. Again, you can see a pretty significant drop. Mm-hmm. And then throughout 2021, that's the blue line in the middle, rates had moved up. And that's why we saw, the market value change in the bonds, just, moving from those low levels in 2020, up a little bit higher, and would expect that, again, short-term rates may move higher throughout 2022. So, that's the prepared remarks that we had for you this evening, and see if there's any questions.
Anyone from the board have any questions?
Yeah, I have a couple questions, if you don't mind.
Sure.
All right, so I see beginning market value, page one, $7,034,000.
Yes.
Then, all right, so now that corresponds now to ending portfolio value, or is that the ending market value? So let's say we started January 1 last year, we had 7 million. This year at the end of December 31st, did we have 7,032,000 at that point? So did we actually lose 2,000? So we lost $2,000 in the investments. Is that right? Am I reading that wrong?
Yeah, correct. The market value is down about $2,000 from the beginning of the year.
Okay. That's correct. Yeah.
You're good. Okay.
Well, we spent $35,000 to lose $2,000. That kind of bothers me.
Well,
but that's the way it goes.
Okay. So, okay. Any other board members have any questions? All right. Thank you, gentlemen. We appreciate your time.
You're most welcome.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay. Our next presentation is from Baker Tilly. It's the 2020-2021 audit for John Compton and John Ettinger.
Okay, thank you. Good evening, everyone. Do a quick sound check. Everything coming through okay?
Yep.
All right. Appreciate the time here this evening. My name's John Compton. With me tonight are John Ettinger and Kate Mowry from Baker Tilly. We are the external CPA firm that does the annual single audit of the school district, and we're here tonight to give you a brief summary of that audit. We'll look to spend maybe 15 to 20 minutes going through this. So it is absolutely executive summary and format. That being said, we're here for you folks. So if there's something that we don't cover in sufficient detail or something you'd like us to explain in more detail, we would be happy to do that. The audit is complete at this point in time. It was delivered on December the 17th, just before the holidays. The district, interestingly, has a December 27th deadline with this audit. It just so happens that December 27th is 180 days after your fiscal year end. And a number of your bond documents have what is known as a continuing disclosure requirement that the financial statements be posted to this electronic municipal market access by 180 days after year end. The single audit itself, from the federal standpoint and the state perspective, is not actually due. Normally, it would have been due March 31st of 2022, but because of all the federal stimulus money that's out there, that deadline has actually been extended 6 months. So that would have brought us to September 30th of 2022. So you got your audit done well ahead of time in this situation. So the audit went well. Your folks, Susan and Joni, are always well prepared. Their day-to-day internal bookkeeping, the accounting is well done. That's been the hallmark of Keystone Central for many a year. That is helpful to us in our audit in the sense that we can kind of focus on the issues. And we certainly don't take for granted that the bookkeeping is done correctly, but we can get right down to testing the numbers versus having to get the numbers to the point where they can be tested, which is the case in some of these audits. So we appreciate that. And in the interest of time here, we'll move right along. If we could, not sure if our slide deck is up on the screen there or not. I'm not seeing it.
No, we'll have Chad's gonna first.
Okay, there it is. I see it now. Okay, there we go. So if we could move along to slide two, John or whomever's running the slide, there's our contact information on slide two, two Johns and a Kate. We are all part of Baker Tilly's public sector group. We're based in Williamsport, Pennsylvania. Baker Tilly is a national firm. We do a lot of public sector work, a lot of school district work. In this vicinity here in PA, we probably have 20 or so school district clients, intermediate unit clients, vocational technical school. So we do a lot of this work. And included somewhere in this slide deck, hopefully you all have a copy, but included somewhere in this slide deck is our telephone number and our email addresses. So if something should come to mind after this meeting, a question or a concern, you can certainly reach out to us at any point in time. John, if we can move on to slide three. Okay, in terms of an executive summary, the whole concept of an auditor conducting an audit, it culminates in an opinion. And we actually give two opinions in your audit. The first opinion is on the financial statements, and the second opinion is on your major federal program compliance. All of that ESSER money and GEARS money and Title I money and so forth all has a lot of federal regulations that you need to adhere to. So we give an opinion on both the financials and the major federal program compliance. Both of those opinions are what we refer to as an unmodified opinion. That means without exception, in our opinion, the financial statements are fairly presented in all material respects. In accordance with generally accepted accounting principles. You may hear us refer to the Governmental Accounting Standards Board. There's a so-called GASB who sets accounting rules for state and local governments, and that's kind of the benchmark against which we would audit this information. So we were able to provide an unmodified opinion on your financial statements, and your major federal programs were that opinion was unmodified as well. You'll also find as we go through the numbers that your general fund balance remains sound. That was just north of $16 million at June 30, 2021. It increased about $451,000, which is all but break even in the context of Keystone's budget. So, excuse me, all things considered from an opinion standpoint, from a financial position standpoint, it was a good result from this audit. Next slide, John. There on slide four, I mentioned that we provide these opinions. If you have a copy of your audit report, that's where you could find them. The opinion on the financial statement appears on page one. And the opinion on the major federal program compliance is back on page 62. And I tell you, the fact that we're able to issue an unmodified opinion on your financial statements, that says something. These accounting rules that are established by the Governmental Accounting Standards Board, they're pretty complex. They're constantly changing. It's not an easy thing to accomplish to get to that point. So that's something the district can take pride in. Okay. At this point in time, we're going to start to focus on the numbers. I'm going to turn it over to John Edinger, and he's going to talk for a moment about your general fund budget performance in fiscal 2021. John, if you would, please.
Thank you, John. Am I coming through? Am I coming through okay?
Yes, you are.
All right. Awesome. All right. Good evening, everyone. And as John had noted, as part of our presentation, we're going to provide some high-level review of the results for this year's financial statement analysis. We're going to start by taking a look at budgeted versus actual activity for the general fund. For those of you following along, you will find this schedule on page 18 of the audit report. Now, as you will note by the title, this report presents the statement of revenues, expenditures, and changes in fund balance, comparative between budgeted and actual activity for the year. While both the original and final budgets are presented on this schedule, I just want everybody to realize the comparative data is based on the difference between the final budget and actual financial activity only. So for the current year, actual revenues were approximately $3,341,000 more than final budget. This was primarily driven by the significant increase in federal and state funding through various COVID-19 related grant awards. The overall variance to budget for federal and state funding was a positive $4.5 million. Additionally, there was an offsetting negative variance of approximately $1.2 million between budgeted and actual local source revenue, which is primarily the district's tax revenue. Expenditures are presented by natural classification derived from various programs and services provided by the district. Actual expenditures for the year were approximately $4,105,000 more than budgeted. The significant drivers of this increase were mainly seen within the special programs and pupil personnel services, which had negative variances to budget of approximately $4.8 million and $2.5 million, respectively. These significant increases were driven primarily by increased spending associated with the ongoing coronavirus pandemic. Conversely, there was a significant positive variance for regular programs of approximately $3.7 million. Most of this noted reduction in regular programs was due to the offsetting increase spending in special programs and pupil personnel services. So at the end of the day, the ending result of this activity, net of the transfer out variance of $1.2 million, was a positive budget variance of right around $451,000, as John had noted. Moving on to slide 7, you'll see a graphical representation of the activity we just went over. And you'll note the variances to budget are very consistent for both revenues and expenditures. With that being said, and if there are no questions, I'm going to hand the presentation back to John Compton.
Thank you, John. Any questions on the budgetary information? Okay, hearing none, we'll shift our attention to fund balance, your general fund balance, which is, we start on page 8. And general fund balance, just to kind of touch on what that means, it's the equity of your general fund. It's the difference between your assets and liabilities. In a lot of cases, when you talk about funds, you might think cash, or cash and bank. It would include your cash. It would also include amounts due from other governments, the federal government, the state. It would include prepaid expenses, inventory, accounts payable, accrued salaries and wages. So it's all sorts of assets and liabilities that net to this residual value that we refer to as fund balance. It's typically used as a measure of the financial position of a state or local government. If an analyst were looking at your financial statements, one of the things they would look to would be your general fund balance to see how much of a reserve or a cushion that you might have within that fund. And there's a Government Finance Officers Association, the GFOA, all kinds of acronyms in this business. I mentioned the Governmental Accounting Standards Board, the GASB. There's the Government Finance Officers Association, who sets best practices for state and local governments. And they, for quite some time now, have indicated that they believe that a government should maintain at a minimum 2 months worth of operating expenses within their main operating fund, which for Keystone would be your general fund. So if we were to take a typical Keystone Central general fund operating budget, if we were to look, say, at fiscal 22, divide that figure by 12 and multiply it by 2, it works out to about $13.8 million. And at June 30, 2021, Keystone had just over $16 million within your general fund balance. So using that rule of thumb as put forth by GFOA, you're in a pretty good position at June 30, 2021. John, if we could move on to slide 9, we'll take a look at the fund balance. Now, nothing is easy in this day and age, and governments will oftentimes kind of partition their general fund balance to earmark certain dollars for certain purposes. And there are different classifications that you can establish, one of which is referred to as a committed fund balance. The governing body of a government, in this case, the school board, would be the entity who would set those commitments on your fund balance. And we can see there in that pie chart that as of June 30, 2021, of your total $16 million fund balance pie, so to speak, $8.9 million of that was committed or set aside by the board for specific purposes. Specifically, $5 million was committed for future PEASRs retirement rate increases. $2.1 million was committed for health insurance reserves. $1.5 million was committed for capital projects, and the residual $325,000 was committed for health improvement programs. There was also, in addition to the committed fund balance, there was a portion that was assigned, they call it, which was $1.3 million, which was assigned for special education. The difference, it's kind of a splitting of hairs, so to speak, but the difference between a committed portion of fund balance and an assigned portion of fund balance is the committed portion, an amount can only be committed by the governing body, in this case, the school board, whereas the assigned portion can be assigned by someone who's authorized by the school board to do that. And in most cases in a school board setting, it's the business manager who would be authorized to assign a portion of fund balance. So again, of the 16 million, which we think is, you know, slightly above that 2 months worth of operating expense figure, 8.9 million of it was committed, 1.3 million of it was assigned, and the residual 5.7 million is what is referred to as unassigned, or those are monies that you could just appropriate for some other purpose kind of going into the next year. John, if we could move on to slide 10, please. There on slide 10, we're taking kind of two different views of the district's general fund balance. The first half of that side, or the left-hand side of that slide, we're comparing the GFOA benchmark of 2 months worth of operating expenses with your unassigned fund balance. So we're comparing the 13.8 million 2 months figure versus the 5.7 million unassigned figure. And you might say, well, you know, we're falling a bit short there. Whereas if we were to look on the right-hand side of that slide, we would see that the district's total fund balance of 16 million exceeds the 13.8 million 2 months worth of operating expenditures figure. The key thing to remember is the difference there between the two would be the committed portions of your fund balance or the assigned portions of your fund balance. And what the board commits, you can uncommit. And what the authorized individual assigns, you can unassign. So that's within your local control. And, you know, just kind of taking all of that into account, Baker Tilly is of the opinion that your fund balance is sound. It's right about where we would expect it to be. And I think I'll pause there and see if anyone has any questions on this fund balance business before we move on.
Does anyone from the board have any questions?
I have a quick question, please.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you. It's very, how you put this together, extremely easy to follow. Thank you so much. Maybe now or maybe at the very, very end of your report, just maybe give us all a summary like, this is really good, this is okay, and this is sort of you should be concerned about.
Sure.
Thank you.
Yes, ma'am. So there on slide 11, we're looking at, John, if you could advance the slide to slide 11, we're looking at a five-year history of the district's general fund balance. And you can see, looking back to June 30, 2017, we were sitting right at about $13.5 million. That was down that year. If we were to look back 1 year prior to June 30, 2016, I think the district was at about $18 million that particular year. So it was on a bit of a downward trend through June 30, 2018, where we hit about $10.6 million. We started to build the fund balance back up in 2019 and 2020. In 2021, although there was about, as we had mentioned, a $451,000 increase there, you can see it's pretty even with where we were in the prior year, which I believe was about $15.6 million. So again, to the young lady's question about items that we feel good about and items that we would kind of keep our eye on, we think your fund balance is solid. We would encourage the district to maintain a fund balance of about that level. We understand, you know, it can be tempting when budgets are tight to kind of dip into that fund balance and use it to balance budgets on a go-forward basis. That's fine too, as long as you have like a fund balance replenishment arrangement where, hey, this year is going to be difficult for whatever reason, we need to use some of that fund balance, but our intent is to build it back up to a level where it is at June 30, 2021. Okay, at this point, I'm going to pass it along to Kate. And she is going to share some historical information where we'll be looking at the district's revenues and expenditures of your general fund over a five-year period. So Kate, if you would, please.
Yes, thanks, John. So like John mentioned, we're just gonna go ahead and start with general fund revenues by source. The graph kind of depicts the last 5 years. You can see color-coded, the local, state, and federal revenues have remained fairly consistent over the last 5 years. However, if you look at the blue portion of the chart, you will notice a significant increase for fiscal year 2021 for federal sourced revenue, which primarily is a result of the funding that was provided as a result of the COVID-19 pandemic. So sort of the ESSER funding, the GEAR funding that John Compton had mentioned earlier. And then if we go ahead and look similarly at general fund expenditures by type over the last 5 years, again, fairly consistent where the largest form of expenditures was for instruction services, so salaries, benefits, those sort of things. There were additional expenditures this year, just over $51 million, again, for COVID mitigation strategies and additional expenditures related to cyber and charter school tuitions. And again, also an additional support services increase this year, which was also due to COVID-19 related efforts. And then if we take a look at capital asset activity, we sort of break this down for governmental assets and then your business type assets, which are related to the food service. For governmental capital assets this year, they were about $49,390,000 net of about $2.8 million worth of depreciation for fiscal year 2021. And if we take a look, there were about $15 million in capital asset additions for the governmental fund, primarily similar to last year, comprised of additions for ongoing ESCO and roofing projects at the district. And then looking at business type capital assets, which, as I mentioned, are related to food service, these capital assets were $76,915 as of June 30, 2021. And this was net of a depreciation expense of just over $14,000 for fiscal year 2021. And then finally, looking historically at long-term debt, you can sort of see it was fairly consistent 2017, 2018, 2019 with a large increase in fiscal year 2020 as a result of new debt issuances. There were no new debt issued in 2021. However, if you notice a slight decline in the graph, that was a result of about $1.7 million worth of principal that was actually paid down on the debt during the year. And then if we look at sort of overall debt service expenditures during the year, they approximate about 2.7% of overall operating expenditures at the district for fiscal year 2021. I think I'll pause there and turn it back over to John.
All right, thank you, Kate. The next several slides, we're going to be going over and discussing the district's pension and OPEB liabilities. So on slide 17, you'll note the schedule of the district's required pension contributions for the Pennsylvania Public School Employees Retirement System. There's a mouthful, or what we like to call PEESRs. For 2021, the district's contractually required contributions totaled approximately $10,302,000. So as you can see, the required contribution for fiscal year 21 has increased slightly over the prior year. And this is mostly due to an increase of approximately $2.4 million in the district's covered payroll. Additionally, the total required contribution rate is determined by PEESRs had increased by 0.22% over the prior year.
John, if I may, for a moment, yes, back to the PEESRs employer contribution rate, just to talk on that for a moment. That's a lot of money. I'm sure the board's familiar with the PEESRs plan. That's a gigantic, we refer to it as a governmental multi-employer defined benefit pension plan. It's underfunded. It was actually going back maybe to 2000, 2001, it was darn near fully funded, but there were some changes to the contribution rates and the retirements. And at one point in time, the employer contribution rate to this plan was next to nothing. It's due to that and due to some investment issues, the plan got to a point where its liabilities exceeded its assets. And the plan required that employers start to ratchet up the amount of contributions that they needed to make. At June 30, 2021, the employer contribution rate was about 33% So for every dollar Keystone pays an employee who participates in this plan, which is the bulk of them, you need to put 33 point some odd cents into this retirement system. That's high. It you know, to think back 20 years ago, this contribution rate was next to nothing. And then over time, it's ratcheted up into the 30s. I guess if there's any consolation, it's the fact that this is kind of stabilized. The plan is improving in terms of the extent to which it's funded. I think the last I saw, PEESRs was 62% funded versus being a fully funded plan, which would be 100%. So our contribution rates are going to be in the 30s for some time. But that's a big piece of your budget. $10 million out of about a typical Keystone budget is 80, 85 million. So back to the question from earlier this evening, this is a challenge, and it's not just Keystone, it's every school in the Commonwealth, it's every intermediate unit, VOTEC school, charter school that participate in this plan.
All right. Thank you for that additional commentary, John.
John, I see a question. Yes. Elizabeth Lynch is asking.
Thank you so much. have you heard or seen anything that any school district is doing that's innovative to bring down our share that we have to pay into? Is there anything you can share with us?
You know, there's nothing that Keystone Central can do. The way that this is allocated is it's a rate. PEASERS will set the rate. And if you have someone who's in that plan, you know, you've got to pay that employer rate. The system itself has been trying to establish, or it has established essentially a what they refer to as a defined contribution plan, like a 457 or 403B type plan, which is more similar to what you would find, say, in a commercial business. Like Baker Tilly, our retirement plan is a 401K plan. The difference there is when someone in a defined contribution plan retires, they take the money they've invested in the earnings and walk away, and that's the end of the relationship. The employer doesn't continue to pay the pension for that rest of that person's existence. So there is an element in PEASERS where there are, I think, new persons who enter into the system. They've got a kind of a quasi-retirement plan where it's partially PEASERS, partially, I think it's a 403B, isn't it, John, Kate?
The PEASERS portion, John?
Yep.
I think you're right. It comes under Act 5 of the pension. I'm not quite sure if that's a 403B or if it's a 451 or how they have it set up. I would have to be honest with you. I'd have to look and investigate that.
So that should help, but you know, short of not hiring employees that will go into the plan, that's the one thing I think you can control.
Yes, Elizabeth.
Thank you. If it's okay with the rest of the board, Susan, I would like to learn more in the future about what he just explained, the share, the 403B, if that was, or whichever category. I would like to learn more about that in the future if everyone else would like to also.
Shaking your head, yes, she can do that for us.
You know, there is a note in the district's financial statements on page 48 that briefly touches on that. So that would be kind of a starting point. In fact, someone's beat me to it there. This is a fairly recent development within PEASERS. Well, it's Act 5 of 2017, so it's been around about 4 years now. So that would be all new hires after June 30, 2011 who elect, I'm sorry, I'm reading up too far. Plans are effective for employees who join PEASERS after July 1, 2019. Total member contributions between the two plans range from 7.5% to 8.25%. So it's for those individuals, it's kind of a mixed retirement, if you will. There's a portion that would be the traditional PEASERS and a portion that would be this defined contribution plan. And I would imagine over time as the legacy employees move on, more and more folks will kind of be in this defined contribution quasi arrangement. And I also would imagine over time, although it will probably be a hard fought battle, there will be more of a move from the defined benefit side of the PEASERS plan to the defined contribution plan side. And again, the difference when we talk defined benefit, that's an annuity that someone has paid for life versus a defined contribution, which is, you know, you're similar to your typical 401k or 403b plan, where the difference really is the risk for a defined benefit plan sits with the employer versus the risk with a defined contribution plan stays with the employee. Okay, John, back to your portion.
Yes,
we're
sir.
We're coming down the home stretch here, folks.
We are. Just a few more slides. So as we've been talking, you know, the pension liability, on slide 18, you'll note the district schedule proportionate share of the net pension liability for PEASRs. And as you can see, there's a large increase in the pension liability for 2021 with a balance of approximately $112 million at June 30, 2021. Now, there are a number of various factors, including current projected market performance, that are the primary driving factors that are bringing this increase to bear. On slide 19, you'll note a schedule of the district's proportionate share of the net OPEB or other post-employment benefits liability for PEASRs. Now, similar to the net pension liability, the OPEB liability has increased as well compared to the prior year. For 2021, the OPEB liability at June 30 totaled right around $4,909,000. And then on slide 20, we see a schedule of the district's local OPEB plan liability, which is separate from the PEASRs OPEB plan liability. Now, the local OPEB plan liability has a balance at June 30 of right around $19.1 million. This again is also an overall increase of right around $2.3 million from the prior year. Now, again, for both the PEASRs and local OPEB plans, you know, various factors, again, similar to the pension, similar factors like the current and projected market performance are primarily driving these increases. So before we move on, is there any questions, any further questions regarding the pension or the OPEB liabilities? All right, that being said, the next couple of slides we're gonna go over briefly, the district's uniform guidance compliance or single audit. So again, for those of you following along in the report, on pages 64 and 65 of the financial statements, you'll see the schedule of expenditures of federal awards. And as the name implies, this schedule kind of outlines the district's total expenditure of federal funding during 2021. If you look at the bottom of that schedule on page 65, you'll see in total that the district expended approximately $8,440,000 in federal financial assistance during fiscal 2021. Now, this is slightly more than twice the expenditures during fiscal 2020. Where the district expended, I believe, last year, right around $4.2 million. Again, the majority of this increase was related to various COVID-19-related grant funding, which totaled approximately $3.6 million. Does anybody have any questions about that? Okay. I do want to say that the single audit went very smoothly this year, as it typically does. We did not identify any findings related to the district's major federal programs that we tested. And then in summary, the audit went very well overall. As John had said, the district's doing very well financially. The district's general fund balance is in line with GFOA. And there are very good internal controls in place. We found no material weaknesses, none were noted. And as I just want to personally thank Joni and Susan and their staff for all the hard work they do, them doing their job well makes it easy for us to come in and do our job. And with that being said, I'm going to turn things back over to John Compton for his concluding remarks.
Thanks, John. Folks, the remainder of our slide deck here, there's probably another 25 or so slides. There are certain communications that are supposed to take place between the audit firm and either the audit committee or the finance committee of a governing body or the full board. We've talked about these communications in the past. We won't put you through them here this evening. But if you would, at your convenience, kind of read that information. Our contact information is included therein if there's anything you would like to discuss. And I think we do have a conversation with the board chair while the audit is going on as it relates to much of what is in the following pages. So we think we've covered the salient points of the audit. I'm happy to answer any other questions the board might have, or if not, or like I had mentioned, our contact information is within our presentation here this evening.
Does anyone from the board have any final questions, comments? All right. Thank you so much. We look forward to hearing from you every year. Joni and Susan and team, thank you. Good job. Thank you so much.
Thank you, everyone. Have a good night. Take care.
Thank you all.
All right. And our final presentation this evening is on the Joinder Grant, Christina Manning and Jim Hicklin.
Hi, thanks for having us. I'm not sure that I see Jim online. Oh, is he by chance in the audience?
Nope.
All right, so it'll just be me going solo. Thank you for allowing me to present this information to you virtually. The COVID has hit our house, so we are under quarantine. I wanted to just give an opportunity to share with you the Keystone Central SAP Expansion Initiative grant that we are able to partner with the Clinton Joinder County MHID. Joinder board. And I've been working with Jim. I knew COVID had hit his house as well, so he was going to have to log in. So hopefully things are okay for him and we'll just continue on. Hopefully it shouldn't take too long. It's kind of exciting. Some quick hitters. So Chad, if you want to go to the next slide. So as I was saying, the Lycoming Clinton Joinder MHID, they applied for a one-time Community Mental Health Service Block Grant for the 21-22 and 22-23 school year. And they chose to partner with Keystone Central School District, which is really exciting. Currently, our involvement with the Joinder Board is, they have two Joinder staff. We call them our SAP liaisons. And they're in our schools, and they our goal is for them to collaborate more with our staff to be more proactive when working with students who may be experiencing social and emotional difficulties at the elementary level. So our goal for this grant is to provide more targeted training for elementary teachers, counselors, school psychologists, social workers, and administrators in the areas of STAP, which is our student assistance program. Right now, our elementaries do not have a formalized SAP program. So this could be an added layer to our MTSS model of support for our kiddos. So during this training, there'll also be training on cognitive behavioral therapy programs that address various student social and emotional needs that come in, that they often come into school with. So in addition to the SAP training, the cognitive behavioral therapy training, we're also being granted with new sensory spaces and items that are provided by the grant that have proven invaluable so far that allow our students to stay in the classroom and be more emotionally ready to learn on a more consistent basis. So Chad, next slide. So why would the Joinder Board want to collaborate with KCSD? So as I initiated or indicated before, we have two SAP liaisons who currently work with our students in the K-12 environment. And they work with students to focus on students who are experiencing signs of social emotional disturbance. What's kind of cool is this year, we have the two liaisons, but for all the years prior that we've been partnering with the Joinder, we've only had one. And they primarily worked with the secondary level students. So the second one that we have added for this school year, she works with our elementary age students. So in continuing to expand our partnership with those two SAP liaisons. The joiner wants, they recognize that the struggles that our district faces with truancy, and ultimately they would like to help us improve our overall graduation rate. So with that, they recognize that the generational and environmental factors that contribute to these struggles have been exacerbated by the pandemic. And therefore, they want to work with our elementary age students and their families to assist them in building that targeted improved attendance, social emotional development strategies that they can support them with as we move forward with this grant. So if we catch them young, then hopefully we can have more success as they get older and our families are more aware of what supports are available to them. I would ask Jim at this point if he has anything to add, but I'm just gonna keep on going. So Chad, our next slide, I'm gonna get into what our grant actually includes. And so as I indicated before, the SAP training through DIACON, that will be provided to any of our elementary teachers, our counselors, our psychologists, our social workers, and any administrators who want to be trained. And they've been really gracious that if we have other teachers at other levels, especially the middle level, they will incorporate them within our training. And during this training, they'll be able to identify mental health issues, social emotional concerns, and truancy issues, but they'll also be able to teach them how to mobilize our school resources and how to remove the barriers that are impacting them from learning. So we have a training budget for our SAP training coming in right around $10,000 that's allotted for that. So our next slide talks about one of the most exciting things that I think that have come out of this grant, and that is our sensory rooms that we are able to create for Renova Elementary, Mill Hall Elementary, and Robb Elementary. And then additionally, we have sensory items that are made available to all of our elementary schools. And we've done this to hopefully reduce the out of class time that's associated with our socially emotionally delayed students who are struggling, and hopefully to reduce the need for hospitalizations and acute care facilities, but also increase the referral support for students and families into other agencies to make sure that they're getting their needs met. And the really cool thing about this grant is the budget for our sensory rooms and items comes in just under $36,000. So if you go to the next slide, I will show you a couple pictures and examples of our sensory rooms that we have already kind of started working on from Mill Hall and Renova Elementaries. These spaces have a variety of tools and activities that the students can choose from to help them calm themselves or to refocus themselves in these spaces. And many of these students use this space as a reward because they have found success in regulating their own behaviors. And in addition to these sensory rooms, it's been really cool. We've been able to collect feedback from our emotional support and autistic support teachers to determine what their needs are for their room. So many of these items are in those emotional support or artistic support classrooms as well. And there is, I can't begin to tell you how cool these spaces can be. There are lots of lights, there's been water, there's been fish tubes, there's been all kinds of crazy putty. As you can see, one of the big things is the teepee, and we have bean bags and different textural spaces and carpets and fidgets, and all of those bins are filled with things that the students can independently choose from. So it's been really exciting. I'm really excited to finish getting all of these other items into the other spaces. And I still have a laundry list. I think every time I open my email, there's another email from somebody asking me if we have monies available for sensory items. So teachers are excited, kids are excited. It's really, it's so heartwarming to be able to see those kids come into those spaces and just see pure joy on their face, or to come in and just to be able to de-escalate or to regulate their emotions. So, yep.
Is there a reason that we're not doing this at Liberty Curtin in Woodward? Is that because we tend to have a higher concentration of students where this is most effective in the other elementaries, or is the lack of space at those schools, or just a lack of funding at this point?
Well, really, mostly for the lack of need, Bo. There really isn't a high need of an actual room for Woodward. Liberty Curtin does have a space that we have quite a few of these items allocated for. And those are the only two. So those are only two that don't have a room, so to speak, but really there isn't much room at Woodward, but the need for that isn't there. But they definitely have the sensory items available, because these rooms aren't just for the AS or the ES kiddos. They're for any student. And we kind of have a stockpile of, as you can see in the one picture, alternate seating. So things that you don't see here are the fidget bracelets, or the putty that they can have, or the texture strips that can go on their desk or under their desk or in their desk, or the bands that can go across their seats and they can kind of kick to keep themselves active. All of those types of supports and sensory items are at all school. And if they're not at the school, they're in my office ready to go to the school, or they're on order. So the one picture that you can see on the far right with the variety of seating too, across that one, that is actually a rug, kind of like you see in the teepee. That's a weighted dog that can go over the lap of a student. And that's a hot commodity. So that was one. And so as we go through this, we're finding too, what items students are using more frequently, and what do we need to be stocking more of so that we can spread the love, so to speak. So really, the rooms, because the grant doesn't allow for us to, it allows us to repurpose a room. So there has to be a room available. So at Mill Hall, there, it's also kind of like, I don't want to say the swing room, but it's for OT as well. And the big swing is there. Our staff have to be trained. The paras have to be trained when students go in there of how to hook it up. And so right now that's a pretty logistical nightmare that we have to get that figured out before we can have students use that swing. So only certain students can use that swing, but everything else in that room is open to any student, whether or not they have an IEP or not. You can see the swing hanging in the left picture there up at Renova Elementary. And again, the OT uses that space as well. So there's a lot of combined equipment in there that's OT related, ES related, and for the grant as well. Elizabeth?
Hi, I'm so sorry you're not, your family's not doing well. So get well, okay?
Thank you.
Thank you so much. You know, I've been a huge supporter. A lot of us, I'm sure all of us are. I'm just going to ask a couple quick questions. And I'm assuming this partnership is only for students that are actually enrolled in the brick and mortar buildings, right?
Correct.
Not for virtual kids, right?
Nope, because these supports are in our buildings.
Right,
the only
right,
supports okay. that could be possible for our virtual students are if they are ever referred to SAP. Okay. And then our teachers know how to address that.
Okay, thank you so much. And then, yes, I mean, given all the challenges that you've mentioned, the numbers, et cetera, I'm gonna ask the $1 million question. Is there gonna be enough staff? I mean, I understand this is the first time, hopefully we're gonna grow from this, but are they gonna be spread too thin?
So for SAP, our goal is to kind of use it as in a collaboration of what they're already doing.
Right.
So they are already having their PLC meetings where they're talking about students and their behaviors or their academic concerns. Okay. The goal behind SAP is to figure out what's getting in the way of them learning and okay. removing that barrier. So okay. this is just kind of like a more formalized process to do things that they're already doing. And it's just another layer of training for them. But as you know, subs are few and far between right now. So we have to really wait to provide our teachers the training over the summer, which means it has to all be voluntary. I would love for everybody to be trained. I don't think this is a training that, you know, could hinder anybody. It only makes you better. It only helps you to understand students' behaviors better.
Sure.
But again, you have to be willing to do that. So, and time is of the essence right now, and especially when there are no subs. And there are a lot of other initiatives that we're trying to get off the ground from our own perspective. So right now, you legally have to have a SAP team. And what was new for me is I knew you needed to have it for the secondary level, but apparently it's K-12.
Yep.
And so we don't have a formalized SAP team, though we are formally doing the same thing. So sure. We're going to kind of experiment with hopefully finding an elementary school who kind of wants to pilot this in a more formal fashion, hopefully at the start of next school year so that we can continue to build. But the ultimate way for that to happen is to also get those staff trained. So, and that will likely have to happen over the summer.
Okay, thank you so much. And then I just had two other, just a quick, if possible, if this is okay with everyone on your team, maybe when this particular program is completed, this particular grant, if maybe you could come back to the board and tell us the highlights, the challenges, maybe where you want to go next. I don't know, but maybe like a follow-up or something.
Yeah, absolutely. It's been really exciting putting these spaces together. You know, they're kind of transient spaces, so things happen. So they look a little different from one week to the next, but I think definitely if you can have an opportunity to get out and check out some of these spaces once they're up and running, I think it would be worth your time.
They're exciting.
I know when I first put it together at Mill Hall, the teachers were like, huh, can we come in here and just kind of decompress at the end of the day? Because we had a water feature and we had our fish tube and, you know, a glow seat, and just, it was just really calming. So there's a lot of things that I think we can replace and we can add to and we can make better pretty cost efficiently. But this was one of the coolest pieces of the grant. And I wanted to make sure that we showcased that so that you could see some of these really cool spaces. I do have a tons of boxes. People still walk by my office and like, did Amazon move in here? Because I still have a lot of boxes to get out. But it is a time-consuming process to get them out and get things set up.
Well, thank you. Great, and get well.
Well, thank you.
Christina.
Yes.
Hey, I'm just kind of curious. The room with the swing in?
There's a couple of rooms with swings, Roger.
Well, the one in the upper left-hand corner.
Okay.
All right, I'm kind of looking at that. There's always... a team member in there whenever those kids are in there, correct?
Oh, absolutely. A trained team member at that, Roger.
Oh, okay, because I'm kind of, you know, because if they're having some difficulties and they need to decompress, you never know. And if somebody's not in there with them, that's not a good thing to be in right there.
As you see it there, there's nothing attached to that. So the parent or the teacher who would come in with them would be the ones who would actually hook it up and get it ready for them. And then they're always in there with them 100% of the time.
All right. Thank you.
Yep. Any other questions about the sensory spaces?
Just get better.
Thanks. All right, Chad, our next slide, please. So for this one, research has shown that cognitive behavioral therapy is one of the most effective treatments for individuals of all ages who experience anxiety disorders. So moreover, cognitive behavioral therapy interventions in the school settings have produced significant results in demonstrating that child anxiety can be addressed and actually prevented through early intervention. So again, another reason why we want to hit our kiddos at the elementary level. So Coping CAP is one of the programs that we get to purchase through this grant. And it's specifically targeted for kiddos with anxiety. And the four components that it hits are teaching them how to recognize and understand emotional and physical reactions to anxiety, clarifying thoughts and feelings in anxious situations, developing plans for effective coping, and evaluating their performance and giving self-reinforcements. And so having all of the materials for this program, as well as all of the training that goes along with it to teach all of our counselors and psychologists how to use this program, comes in at a whopping $19,425. So again, another huge benefit. Chad, if you go to the next slide, along that, Cope to Thrive is another cognitive behavioral therapy program that's designed to help not only children, but teens as well as young adults deal with anxiety, stress, and depression by teaching them how to develop these skills needed to stop negative or unhelpful thoughts and to start thinking and feeling and behaving in more positive ways. So there's studies behind this that, you know, relate to improved self-esteem, healthy behaviors, and academic performance, which again, completely aligns with this grant. And this program, for all of the training that is offered and all of the program materials, is a whopping $34,625. So two great research-based programs that we will have access to at all of the elementary schools and likely the middle school as well. So, and everybody will have trained. And so our students will be able to reap the benefits of those specific programs. Chad, one of our next slides. And the final thing that we're going to get from this grant is back to school events, along with community outreach opportunities to increase our family engagement, specifically with our more at-risk families and students. So trying to get them more involved into the school and building those healthy relationships. So we have a budget in the grant for that of $7,700. So Chad, our next slide. So really this grant that the Joyner so graciously chose us for comes in at a whopping $100,000. And again, we'll be spending that from this school year to next school year. And in our next slide, I really, truly, from the bottom of my heart, want to thank the Lycoming Clinton Joyner Board for choosing to partner with us. I mean, I think this is a tremendous opportunity for our students, our community, our teachers, and our staff, and I'm just very grateful. So our final slide, do we have any additional questions that haven't been asked already?
On the board. Mm-hmm. Well, this is great. It's always great to have grants to help our students and, at all levels, elementary and secondary. So thank you so much.
Absolutely. I know Jim wanted to be here, so hopefully his family's okay.
Hope so. And get well to you and your family.
Thank you. All right. That's all I have.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, so we will move on to our hearing of visitors. We had one visitor signed up to speak. David Dornish, are you on? Mr. Dornish? Okay. Doesn't look like he's on. So we'll move on to our superintendent's report with Mr. Kondo, who's filling in for Dr. Martin.
All right, thank you. I will begin by announcing something that Dr. Martin had asked me to talk about tonight, which is a grant from the Department of Education that has awarded the CTC program here for the district, $3,300 to purchase a Hoyer lift to address program of study tasks in the health occupations class. I know from a purely financial amount perspective, it may not be a large sum, but what I found really interesting about this is only 1/3 of all eligible programs in the state were identified to receive any funding at all. So I just want to say kudos to Mr. Lynch and the teacher for the Health Occupations Program, Ms. Grieb, for working to secure these funds. Next point I wanted to discuss was, of course, our COVID protocols. As everyone know, over break, CDC, Department of Health, changed a lot of the protocols in regards to quarantine and isolation, and even changed some of the definitions surrounding vaccination status. First and foremost, I wanted to thank the administrative team for getting together over break through Christmas, New Year's, and working through and deciphering a lot of the language and verbiage. The help is certainly appreciated, but we met and made sure that our new practices, our new protocols aligned with the board's approved health and safety plan, as well as the CDC and Department of Health guidance. I just would also like to say that those guidelines are, from what I understand, still being reviewed and perhaps refined at the state national level. So I would say chances are we may be talking about some additional changes in the future. But I also wanted to make sure I said something to our parents and our students, as well as our staff. I know that, and Dr. Martin would certainly agree, our folks have done a lot and been through a lot in terms of all these different protocols and procedures and the changes. And just for the parents, again, I appreciate the patience, and I'm sure our administrative group does too at the buildings that, certainly it's been confusing at times for a lot of folks, frustrating as well for a lot of folks. But again, I can't say enough about our staff that has weathered the changes as professionals do. And again, our parents and our students that, yes, there's been hiccups at times, but for the most part, we've had a lot of cooperation and understanding throughout the process. Finally, then, I just wanted to quickly mention Act 91 of 2021. I know Susan had reached out over break, very excited whenever this was passed by Governor Wolf, December 17th, last month. And I think a lot of our folks administratively, I know Tracy and I are very excited about the possibility of substitutes. And what the law did was essentially makes more folks eligible to substitute. So retired teachers, they're now not going to be tied to the PEESERS requirements for a few years. So they don't have to worry about any concerns there. We have some possibility for college students and recent grads as well. And we are going to be working with Source for Teachers, ESS, to try to help and expand our substitute pool as best we can. Yes, folks, I know that it's a struggle each and every day, staffing and adequately staffing our buildings, but we're fortunate that this was passed by the state, and we certainly are going to be trying to move forward and identify more subs and get them into our system as quickly and as efficiently as we can. So that's all I have for tonight.
Okay, thank you.
Yep.
Moving on to committee reports. Finance Committee did meet on Tuesday. Mr. Knopf, you're our chair, if you want to give a summary.
Tracy.
Hi, Wayne.
Could you speak more directly in your microphone?
I'm sorry. Thank you. Can you hear me now?
Yeah, this is an old man, so you got
I know. All right. So, thanks. Mr. Knopf, a brief summary of the Finance Committee.
Basically, we met with Susan the other night to do a refresher for me, I think primarily since I've been away for so long. Financials looked fairly decent up to about 3 years, but there's a couple, I think it was five different line items we have to talk about as far as signing resolutions. One, two, three, four.
Talk closer to your mic.
Okay. Can you hear me, Wayne?
That better?
I could hear you well. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, sorry. Again, there's four different resolutions we have to pass next week dealing with money being put into different reserve funds, and overall look pretty decent. I don't know if Susan has anything you want to add, but it's hard to believe. But,
okay. All right. Thank you.
And safety and security, did you guys meet? Who's your chair? No, he didn't meet. Roger?
Roger's chair.
No, Dan, you didn't meet. Okay. The 12th of January you'll meet. Okay. Under board business, I did forget to say at the top of the meeting, we did have an executive session this evening, January 6th, from 6 p.m. to 6:35 p.m. for personnel and legal matters. And then there's also a LERTA request, which is, we had a resolution back in 2008, it's real estate tax forgiveness for businesses. Well, it can be for businesses. That's for the new Floating Feathers in Mill Hall.
And I have a question on that.
Yes.
Is it going for the industrial manufacturing or the commercial retail?
Commercial retail.
Commercial retail. Susan, you might as well make your way up to the mic here because we're getting to your section. All right. Any other questions on that request?
It's the 3-year defined. The resolution's attached there too for information for anyone that was not on the board in 2008 when it was passed.
And then moving on, we have 7 policies for first read for everybody to look at. If you have any questions on those, contact Mr. Koch. Yes, Elizabeth.
Yeah, are we gonna go over the F section, the treasurer's report and the financial report?
I'm sorry, totally skipped them.
That's okay. It's okay.
I was just getting all excited to get moving. All right. So sorry, the treasurer's report. Does anybody have any questions on the treasurer's report? Okay. Our financial report for statements for November. Any questions?
I have a quick question.
Yeah.
Oh, thank you. I'm just, maybe the financial committee, Susan, think about it, or board members think about it, but because we're having difficulties, just like everyone else, with getting substitute teachers, I mean, me personally as a board member, to track patterns, I would like to see maybe a separate category that it's just when, I'm not talking long-term substitutes, I'm talking short-term substitutes, so we can track how much that's costing us per month, maybe a separate line item if it's not too difficult to put that in there.
It's actually just a specific vendor report. We only contract.
I'm so sorry. I can't hear you, Susan. I'm so sorry.
We contract out our substitutes, so it would be a specific vendor report. I think we could probably break that out by secretarial support and professional staff.
Actually, if you were to look at the list of bills for payment and look at source for teachers, it should be in there, shouldn't it?
Yeah. That's what I mean. It's a vendor report. We don't pay any substitutes, short-term substitutes outside of the Source for Teachers contract.
Okay. Okay. So it's just that one fee we see for sources. Okay. All right. Thank you. I didn't understand that. And then was it page 9 and F2? I think it's page 9, the last page. I don't remember when this, I didn't notice when this got taken out, but if we don't see last year's numbers for page 9, like all the other pages have last year's numbers.
Yeah, I don't think we ever added it in for this one specifically. It's year-to-date benefit costs.
Well, my mistake. I thought we used to, and I just happened to notice that yesterday. Is there anyone else out there that would like to compare, so we have a track of a pattern the year out for this column, for this page also? Would that be, I don't want to put it on hardship or anything, but it just seems it would be consistent and we could see patterns.
I personally don't see a need for that if it wasn't done before. And I mean, when we do the budget year to year, we see any increases, unless anybody else would like to see it.
I agree with you, Tracy. I don't think that's something that we need to have them do.
Okay.
I believe that's actually part of the team's responsibility to keep up with that. So.
Okay.
Okay. Anything else on those, Elizabeth?
No, thank you.
Okay, thanks. And then our enrollment report for December.
Madam President.
Yes, Wayne.
Could we go back to the policies for a moment?
Yeah, let me finish this section quick and then we'll go back to policies, Wayne.
Okay, very fine.
Okay, thanks. Any question on the enrollment reports? I know we've been fluctuating with the whole pandemic and all that. All right, so we did go over LERTA. Okay, Wayne, on your policies, what you got?
I apologize. I'm not as quick on the draw as I should be. I just wanted to point out all these policies are on first read, so this is for everybody's reading pleasure between now and next week. And hopefully will be approved next week on first approval. And I just wanted to solicit any comments from the other members of the policy committee, Mr. Johnson or Mrs. Lynch, do any of you have any comments on any of these policies?
No, they're nothing extensive, but they're just all from the 800 category. And a lot of them are just dealing with, as you can see, their school organization, the kind of thing. And I think, you know, I would just recommend that everybody take a look at them between now and next week, and it is the first read, so we won't be actually approving them till next month. So, but look them over. I think they're pretty straightforward, most of them, and I don't think if you do have any questions, please, get in touch with Wayne or me or Elizabeth. We'll try to answer them.
The last thing I have to say is that the policy committee will meet next Wednesday, the 12th. Of January, 10 o'clock in the morning. Everybody's invited. I hope that we'll have that by, will Zoom be available? Tracy Long, will we be able to get on that by Zoom?
Yes. Yes, it's available on Zoom.
Okay, thank you much. That's all I have. Thank you.
Thank you, Wayne. Okay, did I skip anything else before I move on to section I?
You're good.
All right. So we have our meeting minutes from December, the board reorganization, voting meeting, and the finance committee meetings. Any questions or comments on them? All right. Move on to our business. We have our bills for payment. The total for the month is $3,888,186.67. And then number two here is a three-year agreement between Keystone Central and TransFinder for transportation software paid by the general fund. This is the new software to help with busing schedules, hoping to find some efficiencies and with our shortages of bus drivers, and we're so rural, it's been very difficult. So any questions on that? And then we have the 2020-2021 audit report, and we just had the presentation on. And then number four is resolution 125. This is for us to state we will not increase taxes above the state index, which this year is rather high. What is it, 4 point something? So, but we will say that we're not, if we were to raise taxes, we would not go above that.
What is the index? Is it
4.6%?
4.6.
Okay. And tested Butch. That was just at the meeting the other night.
All right, and then we have resolution 126. We're going to approve a request to adopt resolution 126 to transfer committed funds
from the general fund to the capital fund in the amount of 900 and, am I doing this right? No, 500,000. Mm-hmm. And then the capital reserve committed fund balance would be 973,555. And then the next resolution, 127, we will commit funds for future technology enhancement initiatives as required in the amount of $1 million. The designation is for the purpose of addressing tech needs and providing technology exposure equality to all students in K through 12. Any questions on that? And then resolution, what did I just find? 128, that is directing administration to commit funds for future personnel initiatives as required under committed fund balance account in the amount of $1.1 million within the current district general fund. That's designation is the purpose of addressing future personnel needs. Any questions on that? And then we have an agreement with McClure for the Central Mountain High School auditorium unit replacement, not to exceed $357,467 paid for by the 2020 bond issuance. I believe that and the next item, which is for the CTE chiller repair, not to exceed $33,010. I believe they were both already on our facilities list. We just need to move them up sooner than what we thought. Go ahead, Susan.
Yeah, I think there's, if they're approved tonight, it gives us a chance to get the orders in and have things delivered for a summer repair. If these were to wait until a February vote, you run the risk of having the auditorium down and the chiller down in the fall of next year. The lead time on equipment, you know, it's close to 6 to 8 months at this point. So we're really running into a lot of issues getting equipment and getting things repaired.
Yeah, we're going to run into that, I think, with a lot of our facilities.
Yeah,
we're going to have, we're going to need to approve things maybe a bit earlier than what we had anticipated just because of supply.
Yeah, I think you'll see that with any technology related purchases as well. I know that I'm hearing lead times of 9 months on various things, and it's it seems like any kind of commodity these days is in short supply.
Yeah.
I have a quick comment, please.
Yes, Elizabeth.
Thank you. I am sorely disappointed, not in the staff. They do a fantastic job, but we knew this was coming and we didn't have a facilities meeting. It wasn't discussed during a facilities meeting. So I wouldn't mind if it was maybe 50,000, 80,000, but that type of price tag, and I'm not, again, this has no reflection on our staff. It's just, we have a procedure. So I'm hoping at the next facilities meeting coming up, the committee members can get the major priority list that we know of ASAP. So we'll just focus on the maybe the priority ones. So we're not at the 11th hour again. Okay, that's all our request.
Okay.
If we had had a meeting, would you have objected to this?
I don't know if I would have objected or not, because I don't understand the project at all. And I know Susan's been wonderful. She's been sending information. I know it's gas related. I don't know if it's, I don't know. I don't know anything about it. It's nobody's fault. It wasn't discussed in the committee. And that's when we would learn and ask questions. That's all. So next meeting, we can see where the priorities are.
Well, I think that was the whole purpose. When we had the last meeting in November, we said that in January, we were going to revisit all of these items that are on the 10-year plan. And I think that at this point, the only reason that we didn't, that it wasn't put off until our meeting later this month was because exactly as what she just said, it had to be ordered It was not something that was pulled out of the pie in the sky. These were items that are on the 10-year plan. And it had been, I know that we had talked about this. You knew that back in the summer, we had issues with the chiller. We had to cancel a board retreat because of that, because the chiller was down. And this is not something that is, you know, an item that is unnecessary. And that's why the money has been budgeted. It's been through the bond issue. And I can't see that we needed to have hold off on this. I think Susan sent out the information. I don't see the problem.
No, you're absolutely, no, I understand that. And well put, very well put. It's just, that's why I'm looking so forward to the January meeting to find out what the priority list is. So,
well, I'm sure we'll see it in January, and I'm sure we'll have all of that plus the other information that we were looking to discuss at that point. So get ready for a long meeting.
Thank you.
Elizabeth, I do have Alyssa with us tonight virtually. So if there are specific questions about the project or the need or what it entails, she's prepared to answer specific questions that you may have.
Oh, that's so kind of you. And I don't want to take up a lot of time, but I mean, just from the get-go, I mean, I did not Google all the different pieces, okay? But I was concerned. People are, okay. I don't want to go into a discussion now because again, this would have been during a facilities committee, but hopefully someday, when the timing is right, the technology is right, the grant money is there, when we start going more solar, okay? And now this is taking us back to gas. And I'm not saying solar would be good right now. I'm not saying electrical would be good right now because they weren't discussed. So once we purchase this, we're trapped with natural gas again. So I'm not saying that's a bad thing. I have natural gas at my house, love it, okay? That's not the issue. I'm just talking about green building, green schools. So that was my comment. But again, I am not prepared to ask questions because I was not privy. None of the committee members don't have the information that you have, and I don't want to waste anyone's time. We trust you. We know you're doing what you need to do. But I also like to discuss, well, maybe it should have been electrical with wiring available. So when, if we do go solar, this particular unit might be able to be transferred. Maybe
Elizabeth, this is Rob Pasella speaking.
Hi, Rob, I miss you.
I miss you too. All the things that you're asking are things that we've addressed, and actually we've asked McClure to look harder at what some of the solar incentives and some of those things are. This unit would be able to be connected to our power system, which is ultimately, if we did a solar system, would be somewhere probably near your house, because that's where we have some vacant land, but we could connect it within a 2-mile radius to any of our buildings, and that would entail offsetting some of the cost. This project, although we have discussed a lot of this in the past, I myself and Susan have been very active in trying to talk the price down on some of it. I know it's a big price tag on rooftops, but it's pretty much what we're seeing within the industry. The chiller, we started at 100,000. We worked back and forth from this summer, and I think we're down to, I don't have it in front of me, 33,000 or somewhere in there. So it's been an active thing with both Susan and myself and Mrs. Martin or Dr. Martin trying to get this to where we wanted it. And a lot of the things that I know where a lot of your heart is on some of these things, and we are addressing them. The auditorium, we know, is our major issue, and I want to have that one done before we go into the fall semester, just because of, you know, I don't want mold. I don't want some of the other issues that we've had. So that one has to be done. And when I met with McClure, they're saying, look, we're seeing exactly what Bo's saying. Some of this stuff 9 months out, you know, you got to get this on order. And I don't want to delay it any further. That's why it didn't run any further through committee. It was a budgeted thing. We knew it was coming. I would have normally brought it to you in about March for a summer project, but I'm ordering paint tomorrow because I need paint for summer projects, and I've never ordered paint more than a month ahead of time. So, you know, it's a different world we're in right now, and it's a different market. So we're just trying to stay ahead of you.
No, I appreciate that, Robin. You know, I'm one of your biggest champions. Okay.
Thank you.
And so I'm looking forward to the next conversations, but I will say this in the contract, I'm a little nervous when I saw the things at the bottom of the page, the exceptions, if you find asbestos, they're not dealing with if they find this or not. And so that's might be another layer of more money we're going to have to put out if they find things. And the other thing I was real concerned about is it's only a 1-year warranty. And I was taken aback by that. I mean, it just seems like we could have bought it maybe, or is there an extended warranty we could buy? Or maybe this piece is so wonderful, 1 year is not a problem. I don't know,
typically everything we order through, most of the projects we do carry a 1-year warranty. There is some additional warranty that's on the machines, that some compressors, some different things that will be covered by a factory warranty. We really go with what's the industry standard. Most of this stuff isn't going to break in the first 5 years. And if it does, McClure is, I have stuff at the middle school that we're working with that's still from the construction project 2 years ago, and they stand behind it and they haven't charged me for much of that stuff. So that stuff's addressed. The high school, with the exclusion list that you have at the bottom, or you see at the bottom, we're not going to find asbestos and some of those things because of being building, it's 22 years old. So we try and stay ahead of that stuff, but some of that's just blanket language that we see in most contracts. I'll try and stay ahead of it and head off any change orders.
Thank you, Rob. You guys, seriously, we're very fortunate to have you and Susan on this. And I want to make sure everyone knows that. But thank you very much. I feel much better.
Alyssa, real quick, can you just give us a real quick idea about what we're talking about here with these units and so on, and why you recommended these for these particular projects, or Dawn, whichever one?
Yeah, I'll let Don put these two proposals together. So I supported Don, but he knows the details much better. So go ahead, Don.
So for the auditorium, the one area we wanted to address as a critical point was the moisture in the space. With the newer technologies on this unit that we're going to put in for that auditorium, it provides the ability to reheat the air, to be able to provide a dehumidification cycle. It also has a variable capacity, which allows that unit to ramp up and down based on how many people are in the auditorium at a time. So one of the main issues you run into with older equipment is its size, typically for a full space. If there's nobody in that space, it's still trying to cool, and so you get a higher humidity issue. This equipment is designed to be able to compensate for that, essentially, by reheating the air. For the chiller repair, we took a look at that. The chiller is running about 50 to 75% of capacity. As Rob mentioned, we had looked at replacing that chiller, but I think the best option was to get that chiller to a point that it was operational. And there were two chill water taps put in as well. If it would ever have a catastrophic failure, that you would be able to bring in a rental. But for the repairs, we're going to be replacing some condenser fans on that unit and some contactors to help bring that bring that unit back up to 100% capacity. Still an older chiller, but we believe that that'll give you additional runtime for the foreseeable future.
Well, that give us buys a couple more years with it, or what?
That was the idea of it, to give you solid operation until you're able to look at that long-term plan, determine exactly what you want to do moving ahead. In addition, with that, like the repairs, we also put in those temporary hookups that Rob would be able to bring in a chiller as a rental if you did have an unforeseen failure of that chiller, so you wouldn't be down for very long. That's usually able to be brought in about 24 to 48 hours off in that time. So we think that's providing you a short-term and ability to look at a long-term plan for the district.
Yeah, it sounds like you've covered all the bases as far as what we need. So thank you very much.
That particular chiller isn't showing any health issues with the compressors or anything like that, like burned oil or anything like that, that you can see through the sight glasses?
No, we took a look at it a couple times. In an ideal world, it'd be great if you could replace it, but it just didn't seem to make sense. In the areas that it needed repairs on were more on the contactor. So there were some electrical components and condenser fans. The compressors, we were able to actually test run them by jumping out some stuff just to make sure that the integrity of those compressors was intact, and they were. So we believe making these smaller repairs will get you back to where you're at full capacity of that chiller.
Well, contactors and fans aren't that expensive. Compressors get to be that.
Yes. Way. Yeah.
Yeah, they're the.
Tracy, I have one question.
Yes.
Go ahead. And it's probably for Susan or Rob. I'm still not totally sure with CoStars, but do we not bid anything anymore? I mean, do we have other bids for this project, or is it we just go with what McClure Engineers says they want, and then they're part of CoStar, so therefore, is CoStars always the cheapest source, in other words? Is there a guarantee that CoStars is the best deal we can get?
With this particular project, we went with the CoStars because of the lead time and the expertise that they've been in all of our other buildings.
So that's, you're not telling me that it's cheaper. You're just saying that it's more convenient.
Well, it's already pre-bid. It is bid.
Right, okay.
CoStars is bid for the entire state. So that is a legal bid process. So I start with that. The other projects, we didn't just go with CoStars. We went with the JOC, which is also a legal bid process. Yeah.
So local businesses would have a chance if anybody was involved with this to have a chance to bid on these projects, correct?
Okay. Yes.
If they want to go through the hoops to get on CoStars, absolutely.
Why would they have to be part of CoStars? Just out of curiosity sake. Now, I'm not necessarily thinking engineering. See, I'm thinking more, let's say we're buying paper for the school. Yes, the state has a certain price that they go out for the entire state. We might want to join in that and get that price. We could go with a consortium. Mm-hmm. They bid out somebody else. But let's say some mom and pop operation has a great deal. Are we eliminating them because of this, the way that system is set up, or do they still have an opportunity to bid even though they're not part of CoStars or part of the state's bid system?
I would say this particular project, if they weren't part of CoStars, they weren't included in that vendor pool.
Okay.
And the same with the JOC, but when we do a project like that, we give a JOC contract, they pick a subcontractor. We have asked all the time that they use local subcontractors to come in.
Okay,
so in a sense,
the bid doesn't go out in the newspaper like the old days way back when.
Not this goes particularly the for system. These ones, but we do still, for your example, on paper.
Right.
Supplies, but all of that still goes out.
But not for the mechanical paper. Engineering and things like that. That was
this one we have not.
Okay.
This one we did not.
I'm just curious.
Randy, one of the other great advantages of using state contracts like CoStars and to some degree PEPM and, mm-hmm. and some of those other contracting vehicles is that the contract language is already established. It's already passed Commonwealth legal. It's been through the Attorney General's office. So we don't have a months-long process trying to get terms and conditions approved, which can minimum. Easily happen with other vendors, because as a governmental entity, we have certain things that we can and cannot agree to.
Right. And it's a minimum, 4 to 6 weeks if we did our own bid on this project. But we would still need McClure to help with the specs.
Right.
They would still have to help write the spec report. I was going to mention something else too. You said PEPM. They also have all of the bid specs already in place in legal language for things like ESSER funding. Mm-hmm. Not everything is like that. Right. So we wouldn't be able to use ESSER funds and just go out and do anything. It has to have specific legal language, and PEPM meets that language.
Okay. Just curious. Yeah. Thank you.
Randy, if I can offer another comment on that too, and I think I understand kind of where you're going with some of that, and I have looked at both ways on some of these projects, and I'll use Bucktails, the renovations that we did with the window wall, and we ended up going with Crabtree on it. I had done that through a JOC number prior to us going to Crabtree to have them do it, and at the end of the day, it's really hard to compare complete apples to apples, but they were very close in what they ended up costing us. Whether we're paying for the engineering through Crabtree or we're paying through the engineering through the JOC, we eliminated some costs with bidding, or we would have eliminated some costs with bidding the one way. So we looked at that both ways, and I've looked at a lot of these projects both ways. When it works out, most of the time, it's nearly a wash. And the one good thing about when McClure gives us a price on something, we don't get change orders. Although Elizabeth talked about some of those exclusions at the end, most of the time when I work with their project coordinator that is on that project, anything that comes up like that, I give them to waive it. They don't charge us for that. So we eliminate some of that change order stuff. So although it's a hard number to always get perfect, because it's really hard to compare, but we are looking at that, and I'm trying to stay on top of that because I don't want to have everybody say, well, they're just relying on the JOC or just relying on McClure or whatever. We look at that to try and keep everybody, you know, I guess keep them honest is what I say in my world, but, you know, we work back and forth.
Thanks, Rob.
Yep.
Okay, we all good on that? If in the next week you have any other questions, forward them on to Susan, to Rob, and they can forward them on to Alyssa and Dawn if necessary and get any more information. All right, thank you for coming tonight, Alyssa and Dawn, appreciate it. And moving on to personnel, we have various leaves of absence, employment, transfers, all that good stuff. Anybody have any questions on that? And then there's also an approval list for club advisors for the 2021-2022 school year. Looks like there's just two there. And moving on to curricular, co-curricular, we have our athletic personnel list, including some volunteers. And we have an intern letter of agreement with LHU. Any questions on that? Okay. Moving on to our students, we have some overnight field trip requests for different things, band, chorus, Skills USA, PMEA. Any questions on those?
I have a quick question.
Yes, Elizabeth.
It seems like every time, well, first of all, everyone loves it when the kids can get off campus and experience something else. Okay, we're all for that. But every time this comes up, it always shows the cost, and there's never a cost. It's always left blank.
A lot of Susan, is this cost to the district that's listed there? And if there's no cost to the district, is that because the clubs are covering it? Or?
Yeah, the form should say paid for by KCSD or not paid for by KCSD at the top.
Okay, at the top. Funding school, staff.
So I was on Skills USA. That's paid for through the club, student club, and it says not paid for by KCSD. Okay. Just as an example.
Right. Well, what I'm saying is every year this comes up, and every year someone seems to ask the same question. I mean, can we consider redoing the form or something? So it just stipulates it. It's being paid by this, it's being paid by our estimated cost, or however you feel, just so it's clear, so we don't have to ask the same question every year.
Elizabeth, I think if you look at the ones that are paid for by KCSD, specifically I'm looking at the PMEA band orchestra chorus competition. It does say that there is $200 budgeted for that trip.
And I'm looking at the one for the Bucktail High School chorus, I think it is. And it says it's paid by KCSD. It's $50 travel, $150 fees, and $120 hotels. It's all listed on, even has the ASN number.
ASN, yeah.
It's, yeah, they're typically listed on it.
Yep, there's a whole section. Yep, a pay for by KCSD. Any other questions?
Oh, so I'm sorry. So on the form, I missed it. I rewrite them and I missed how it's being paid for and the cost.
Mm-hmm.
So
That's right.
Yeah, underneath where the location and time is for everything, there's a section that says paid for by KCSD and says yes or no in any amounts that are necessary.
If it's
how I missed
KCSD, you may be looking at the form that says not paid for by KCSD, which means
yeah,
a column.
Okay, so I'm not looking, I'm not reading it properly. I'm not looking at the right one. My fault.
Right. Don't look at the Skills USA one because we're not paying for that one. You'd have to look at one, any one of the other ones.
Yeah. Just
okay.
Top part of the form.
Yep.
Which says whether it is or isn't.
Yeah. I was a little confused on that one too, till I figured out.
Okay. Well, Susan, if you ever think that, I mean, I just needed, if you ever think that you're the former, whatever you want to do, but it just seems like every year I'm confused by this and I'm sorry, it's my fault. But I'm done, but thank you so much. I'm seriously, I love these programs. Looking forward to seeing some of the stuff in the newspaper or whatever they want to do it, newsletters. It's great stuff.
Okay, so that brings us to the end of our agenda. Do any board members?
Madam President, I have something I'd like to discuss.
Of course
you do. I warned you.
Yes, Randy.
It's going to be quick.
Okay.
I did a shorter version, I think.
All right.
Okay, basically, Susan, you're going to get really mad at me just for a second, but I will explain. I believe there's two ways of balancing the budget. We're doing it the wrong way. We need to, as board members, our job is to look at the part of things, the financial stability of the district and of our taxpayers. Continually taking our reserves to balance
the budget. Speaking the microphone.
Oh, sorry, Wayne. To continually use our reserves to balance the budget is never a balanced budget. A balanced budget is how we handle how we live at our house. If I bring in $1,000, I hope to God my bills aren't more than $1,000. I may not have a savings account to take from, and I may not have no other source. This year, we balanced the budget we're balancing our budget the wrong way. We can't continue. If you look at our numbers, which if you go back and look at the Finance Committee meeting, 24-25, we're short $8 million. 25-26, we're short $10 million. 26-27, we're short $13 million. Those numbers are not acceptable. And yet this district is running like those numbers are. Yes, many things can happen between now and then. We pray some of the lawsuits that are taking place in the state right now will fix some of the current funding issues with charter schools. There's many things that can happen. Insurance rates may not be as high. Payroll may change and vary. PESRs may vary. But the hard, cold facts are this year, revenue, $77 million. Expenses, $82 million. Who's not understanding this? This isn't going to work. This is not sustainable. I hate to say it. I'm going to say this out loud. COVID funding bailed us out. There's no way of getting around it. COVID funding helped bail us out. We need to start saving money. So I'm asking my fellow board members, I'm sending something to Personnel Committee. We need to look at right now. Let's just take a quick look. $500,000 savings. Non-teachers. We keep counting on our teachers to retire to help balance our budget. That is not a good business. That's not a good model to run anything on. It's counting on people leaving in order to help balance your budget. Good God, we have to do better than this. We need better out of our administration. There has to be ways to look at how we can save money. Non-teaching positions, maybe we need to take a hard look at it because we need teachers to teach the kids. That's why we're here. And that's the only reason we exist is for the teachers to teach the students so the students can learn. Many factors go into that. Mental well-being, food, transportation. But at the end of the day, we need teachers to teach the kids. So I suggest those five cuts are going to be non-teaching positions. Maybe there's a retirement that we don't replace this in the administration side. But as board, we owe it to the public and to the voters to do the right thing. We can't count on the state to do the right thing. We can't count on them to realize that the charter funding is not fair. I mean, there's many things we can't count on the state or the federal government for that matter. But we have within our power to start taking a look at this and saying, no, that blue line of expenses has to come down some manner. We don't have a product like a business like Walmart does, or like First Quality produces, where they can raise the price arbitrarily. Our only recourse, basically, besides trying to have some of the programs, which were nice ideas, is to raise taxes. You can't keep beating a poor dead horse. Everybody's paying their more than their fair share of taxes. Just go around right now and try to look at what's cost of taxes if trying to buy a house in Lock Haven. Property taxes. They're terrible. We have to take it upon ourselves to say, enough's enough. We have to have cuts. They're not going to be easy. They're going to be hard. But if we don't do that, what are we doing to the next board members? What are we doing to the people, our kids who are graduating, who might actually want to stay in Clinton County? We're saying, well, yeah, great, stay. You're going to be taxed to death, but you stay. That'd be great. So all I'm asking my fellow board members is to start taking this really hard, serious look at what can we do to save money? And I don't know what to do. I mean, I'm at my wit's end, besides cutting, trying to cut positions, looking at programs, don't want to. But we were here, I think, what, you were on the board, I think Jeff, you were a few years ago. And it was pretty rough that night up in Bucktail. I don't think anybody wants to be there again. I don't think the staff wants to be there again. People are worried about, am I going to have a job? Am I not going to have a job? That's terrible to live that way. But that's what we're putting ourselves right back into the same boat again. We have to do it. We have to make them, we have to, you know, pretty much, unfortunately, go to Dr. Martin and say, cuts need to happen. Maybe next year it's another, maybe next year it's $1 million we have to do. And that won't even be enough. We still may have to raise taxes and do something like that. But if we don't start doing it now, I mean, why not do it now? We're $16 million in reserve, but why aren't we doing that now? We can't keep watching. I'll give you an example. 22-23, $82,670,000. 23-24, these are the expenses. Estimated, here again, won't be those exact numbers, but they're estimated. 84,700,000, 24-25, 87 million. 25-26, 90 million. 26-27, 94 million. Here's a real fun fact for y'all. Revenue projected in 26-27. Remember, I said expenses were 94 million. Estimated, 80 million. $14 million difference. Keep that number in mind, $14 million difference. How do we fix that? We fix it by starting now, while we're not in terrible, terrible shape, and we try to prevent those numbers from getting where they are. You heard the auditors. They made the comment about pulling money out of your reserves. Do you have like another fund to pull that money, to replace that money that you take when you spend the reserves? We don't. There's no fund whatsoever besides a tax increase. Or we cut. I'd rather cut on our own accord, do it when people don't have to panic. It's not like, oh my God, what are we going to do here to save this money? I'd rather do it methodically and plan it out. Whether it's $1 million a year for the next couple of years, still is not going to solve the problem farther out, but it's going to make a heck of a difference. So I'm just asking my board members to think about that. And maybe there's other ideas, guys. I hope there are. But we have to start looking at that. Because if we don't, we're doing a disservice. None of us, I don't know why I'm even on here. We're doing a disservice to the public if we can't figure out a way to keep, help get this budget fixed.
I think Elizabeth wants to talk, and then if I can get in line after you.
Go ahead, Elizabeth.
Thank you. Randy, thank you so much for bringing this up. And no one wants to raise taxes. And I feel uncomfortable not raising taxes, to be honest with you, because of those projections. Of course, no, I don't want to raise taxes. That's not the issue. But what I would like to just segue off of what Randy said is, we used to have a task force and they found great cuts. And I'm not saying we should do that again. I'm not recommending that, but I'm saying I would like to see the board in cooperation with the administrative team to formulate someone, this person, and come up with some ideas. And just saying, oh, that's administration's job. You go do it. Well, sure, we can say that, we're board members. But no, I think each of us has our own resources, our own intelligence, our own background. And I think Randy just hit on something, is that I think we should also be a part of that and not just sit there and point fingers and try to blame someone because they didn't balance the budget. Now, I'm not saying, Randy, you didn't do that, but I would like the board to have a special meeting, not executive session, but just to discuss this and what we can do as a group. I'm all for that. I really am, because I've been looking at those numbers now since we've had the task force, and they're huge. And again, most of us, some of us won't even be here then. And I don't believe in leaving legacies like that. That's not who I am. I'm sure that's not who you are either. So I'm thank you, Randy, for bringing this up. I'd like to be instead of shuffling this off and not speaking about it again, let's keep this on the radar and decide when we're going to talk about it. Does that sound like a plan?
Yep.
Yep.
I guess where I would go with this, Randy, is I know what chart you're looking at. I've been seeing that chart now for at least 4 years, maybe a little bit longer. And according to that chart 4 years ago, we should be $20 million in the hole right now. We should be broke,
right.
But we're not. And that's because we've done some amazing things in terms of already making cuts. The other piece of it is we have had a balanced budget. We have not invaded the fund balance at all during that time. We have not taken any money out. The fund balance has increased every year since then. So I'm sorry, I don't believe the chart that you're looking at because it's lied to me for 4 years. I know that it's projections, and the projections are what they are based on the conditions at the time, but we've got some people who've been financial wizards and have done some amazing things. I'm not saying that we shouldn't talk about this. We need to have these discussions, but I think you're going to find even in the non-instructional realm that we're already running pretty bare bones. There's no fat left to trim. We're going to be cutting meat, and that's going to put extra burden on the staff who wouldn't get cut, and we're going to find them trying to find other jobs as well.
Well, I'd just like to point out one line. to balance the budget this year, ESSER grant, you're right, not reserve, $5,200,000.
But we also spent a lot of money on things related to that that we would not have spent.
Right, which I'm not going to disagree with you on. Honest to God.
That's right.
But what I'm going to is when you get to 24, 25, but there's no more ESSER funds left, how are you balancing the budget then? Because you're looking, I mean, like here again, you're right. I agree with you. They're projections. They're not, it could be totally different numbers. But the way we've been going for years, the expenses outnumber revenue. Is there any reason to assume that logic won't continue?
But I do think, as Bo pointed out here, that we have, they have, the people that have been working with this have done a very good job. I don't agree with you that the ESSER funds have bailed us out, because I don't believe that. I think they have, Dr. Martin, Susan, all the people that are in charge of bringing this information to us and creating these budgets, I think that a tremendous job in dealing with the staff, with the, you say about we're depending on people retiring. Well, sure, that's part of it. That's always going to be a part of it. But I think they have a plan that has made sense. And yeah, those are numbers are scary. But like Bo said, those numbers have been there for how many years? And we've been able to manage to get back here without hitting the fund balance and without raising taxes.
And how many teachers did we cut a couple years ago?
Well, that was a couple years ago, but we've in the past, those have, that has been, right. Well, yeah, at that time, but right now we're in pretty good shape. And most of those, if not all those positions, have been returned. So I think what we've got right now, I think maybe you're pressing too much of a panic button here. I think they've got a plan. They've presented, Dr. Martin has presented to us, Susan's presented how they have that set up so that we won't get to that. I don't want to hit the fund balance. I don't want to raise taxes. Nobody does. But we have been very fortunate the last 2 or 3 years, and we haven't had to ask people, especially during COVID and all this. I think we've been extremely fortunate not to have to hit people for a tax increase. And maybe that's going to change next year. But you know, I just think that this is a lot of hyperbole here, and I think that this is stuff that I think you're painting a much more dire picture than it really is. And I think we need to give them a chance to let this thing play out. They have a plan. She sat there and explained it to us. We've heard it in the personnel meetings. We've heard it in the finance meeting. And if you know, everybody's open to go to the finance committee meeting. That's not a closed one small committee meeting. If anybody wants to go there, I just,
Well, the same, if person, we start, the same person, sorry, Susan, the same person that we're saying is doing a great job, which I agree she is the same person who came up with these numbers.
I know that. So and you, those you, are you projections. Can't
have it both ways. Well, oh, I love her here, but I'm not so sure about her.
Those
here.
Are projections.
I trust these numbers. I trust
can her. I interject something here?
Yeah, Mr. Knopf.
Really seems like it's February 2nd to me. This is Groundhog Day. This is stuff like we talked about in 2008, right. 2009. It goes on. Every year you talk about exactly. stuff, looking ahead. But one thing that caught my eye, again, I've been around it in 4 years, but it looked to me like you balanced the budget in like 2020 by borrowing an additional $23 million. But we were set to go with debt-free, probably about 24, I think, was debt-free. Now you borrowed enough money to go another 23. I think it's $23 million I looked at, which kind of baffled me. So, yes, you're
speaking the microphone, please.
Sorry, Wayne. Yes, you have a large fund balance, but it's because you borrowed extra money. I know that money's earmarked for construction and your 10-year plan. So it's borrowed for a purpose, but we have to look ahead, like Randy said, and start planning now to cut this thing. And I would assume by looking at the 10-year plan you had that Susan made up and Rob, I think it's Rob, yep. made up, you have an idea what you're going to need to do. Now we have to figure out a way to pay for it. So that's, we have to let them do it. That's why we pay them the big bucks, so they can come up with these plans and tell us what they recommend. Our job then is to decide what ideas to accept. So I think we have to let them do their job and tell us. I think they looked at the same paper that we looked at the other night, Randy, that saw that in a couple of years we're going to be in dire financial straits. But it seems like Jeff said, it seems like every year they find a way to move ahead. Are we going to have to cut some funding? Oh, yeah, definitely. We're going to have to find a way to cut some additional funding, or if not, we're going to be sinking. So, but.
Regarding the bond issuance, I don't think it was last year. I think it was the year before, but the date is not important. That really did not go to balance the budget. That was used entirely for capital projects, so it had no impact whatsoever on the general fund.
Well, yes, it doesn't impact directly, but it does indirectly, because money that you didn't borrow, you still would have to take money out for those capital funds. So you would have to take it from somewhere. So yes, you can say it was earmarked for capital funding, but if you didn't borrow that money, you would have to take it from somewhere else. So you're trying to take replacing Peter because you took from Paul.
I mean, the roof needed fixed. It would have had to come from
somewhere.
But I don't think a lot of those projects would have had to have been done, but we had the opportunity. At that point, those interest rates were so completely low that we would have been crazy not to do that at that point. I mean, there are a lot of things in these buildings that have been, as you know, Butch, they've been shoved in the back burner year after year after year.
Because we didn't have the funding, because we looked at that projection. So right. We're going to be, you know, $4 or $5 million out. So we put projects off that needed done, or we were patching roofs and patching chillers that probably should be replaced, but instead we have to repair it.
So, but yeah. My experience with this place has been that when we start talking about cuts, what was the first thing that always got cut in the past? It was always, well, let's put that roof project off till next year, and so we can save $100,000 in the budget. I mean, that's always where it got hit. And so we nickeled and dimed and band-aided for so many years, then all of a sudden all these things have to be done. And so we had the opportunity to borrow the money, and you're right, we'll have to pay it back. And that goes into your debt.
I'm not opposed to borrowing the money when the interest rates are as low as they were. So you know, that made good financial sense. But yeah, so but just that it's the big picture we're looking at. We borrowed the money, now we have to pay it back. We got all the projects done. So now we don't have to take the money from our reserve funds to pay for it. But we have to find a way to come up with that $14 million in 3 years. So
well. Another point to be made in terms of the bond issuance is a large amount of that was related to the ESCO project, the energy savings project.
Right.
So even though that debt is sitting out there, it is being paid by the savings we have in energy, in money that we're not spending elsewhere. That's taking care of that debt service. And that's basically guaranteed by the contractor that mm-hmm. if we don't save the amount of money that was projected, then they got to pay the bill.
It's on them. And that's a very good point, though.
Polly.
Sorry, I don't mean to interrupt. I just,
I guess my opinion on it is I feel like I agree where Randy's coming from. We have to I would much rather be able to make this plan ahead of time as to where we're going to spend the money versus, you know, it comes down to the wire and we're saying we're not going to be able to make this budget. We got to consolidate schools, or we got to make rash decisions and cut 10 positions. And, you know, I feel like going into it with a plan is better than making rash decisions because we don't have any time to think about it.
When are we going to have our first budget presentation to the board? That normally happens February timeframe, correct?
It was either
January or February. Yeah, it was supposed
to
be tonight,
but it got moved to next week because we had other presentations.
If history repeats itself, I'm going to guess it's probably going to show. Now, I don't know with the ESSER funding or so forth, but I'm going to guess it's going to show that we have a fair deficit. But somehow in the last couple of years, we started out a million, million and a half, 2 million in the hole in January. By the time we get to May, we've got a balanced budget. I don't know what kind of magic goes on there, but it's just the way history has been.
Yeah. I mean, as of now, the projection is that we do have a balanced budget at this point for this year.
And I think that's what they said to us 2 months ago in that first presentation. Yeah. And that's why I said, you know, we need to have faith in what they're doing here. And you're right, Bo. I mean, that's exactly what's happened the last couple of years. I mean, they've been able to find the ways to through staffing moves and so on that we get it down there. And it's been pretty amazing. We've been able to do that without tax increases. So
between our finance committee meetings and then our other committee meetings, we are always looking for ways, and Dr. Martin has brought up several times looking ahead and planning for the future, especially in the personnel realm and facilities. So the finance committee meetings, they are the best way, but starting next week, we do have the next budget presentation. So I told Randy he had some suggestions for savings, and I asked him, and it's in personnel, and I said, can you please write it up and send it to us? And the personnel committee will definitely go over it, take it to Dr. Martin, take suggestions there. So I encourage all board members to do that. If you think of a way for savings in any department, whatever, just send it to the appropriate committee and we will definitely go over it. Yeah, I don't disagree. And unfortunately, like, you're right, we don't have a product we can raise the prices on. So until the government starts helping, you know, it's going to hurt. So, but we are, our admin team is doing a good job looking forward. And, but yeah, it's going to get interesting in the next couple of years again.
I want to say I do have faith in what they're doing. Lord knows I have lots of faith, but I feel like maybe having a backup plan, you know, an idea of, you know, what if they don't work their magic, what are we going to do? You know, have that plan ready. So this is going to be our first step. If that's not good enough, well, then this will be our second step. You know, just some sort of plan devised ahead of time so that we're not making a decision. And, you know, I'm completely opposed to cutting teacher positions and I don't ever want to see that happen again. It hurt a lot of people, including the kids in our district. So I just think that it would be a good idea to have that plan in place and hope that they can work their magic. And if they do, then we don't have to implement our plan. You know, it doesn't hurt to have a plan.
You're right. Okay, thank you. Anyone else?
I'll make a motion.
Madam President.
Oh. Yes, Mr. Koch.
There's one other dynamic to add to this debate.
I have a feeling I know what you're gonna say, Wayne. Go ahead.
The reason for a lot of our financial problems is the fact that the state of Pennsylvania has been sitting on its dead mule for a long time when it comes to subsidizing public school education. And perhaps it would behoove us to come up with a program of constantly agitating the state legislature to get off its dead mule and fight and proceed to finance public school education at a level that it used to once upon a time. The amount that the state has been putting in education has been declining, and the burden has fallen on local school districts. And of course, I know the argument about keeping it at the local level and local control and all that, but you see the economic problems you're running into, and you know, with the battle, our balance, we try to maintain a balance between being responsible to the taxpayers and also being responsible to the students that we serve. And the state is becoming less and less helpful. So we ought to become more of a pain in the butt to the state legislature to get off of its dead mule to start financing education more equitably.
Yep, you're right. The funding lawsuits are underway again, and also the charter funding legislation is always to pick up some steam. It's kind of, I think, haven't heard too much lately on it. But so, as always, I encourage board members to keep up with that, and keep up with it through PSBA and their advocacy. And hopefully our legislators start listening to the districts, and we can get some more equitable funding.
So that you mentioned that lawsuit, and I don't know whether anybody saw the PSBA daily thing that comes out every morning. But when I read some of the questioning that the legislature's attorney was asking, it was absolutely idiotic. And I know he was doing it for effect, but when he asked questions like, what does somebody that is going to be working at McDonald's need to know about Algebra 1? Or what does a kid that's going to be flipping pizzas need to know about biology or a carpenter? Those kind of questions indicate the type of mentality that you're dealing with the people who hold the purse strings in Harrisburg. And Wayne is absolutely correct. They don't value public education. I think they would be like, they would rather farm it out to charter schools and everything else. We need to voice your opinion to those people that are behind this lawsuit, because if they're successful, it's going to help everybody. Because Wayne's right, the amount of funding has gone down. And they're not holding up their end of the deal. So it just was really, really irritating, to say the least, to read that.
Elizabeth?
Thank you so much, Jeff. Seriously, thank you. In fact, I know legally we're not allowed to endorse any candidates. We can't talk about politics. We're apolitical. Hallelujah. But I will say this. When I vote for someone, I'm talking about myself here only, I'm not endorsing. I look at what is their philosophy, principles, track record when it comes to funding X, Y, and Z. That's how I pick my candidate. So I just want to put that out there. But thank you so much, Jeff.
I'm just got to say I'm amazed, Mr. Koch, that I didn't hear the word snakes or weasels come out of your mouth.
Oh, I was thinking worms.
Worms, that would be another one.
I was just going to say, I think I heard that same speech in 2016. Yep.
So, yeah. Wayne is our advocate, that's for sure.
It doesn't mean it's not true.
There was a governor's debate, I think, last thing. One of the biggest things they talked about there, from what I saw, was the school choice. They're all in favor of school choice, which could be harmful.
That's rough. Okay.
Madam President, I'll make a motion to adjourn.
I have a motion to adjourn.
I'll second.
And a second. All right, everybody. Thank you so much. Everybody's have careful. A good evening. Be careful.